Hello guys, I think we'll start with the cockpit. It's the thing that's changed the most. It's the third edition of its instrument panel, and it's the last edition of its instrument panel. Walk right this way. This airplane, I generally just call it the doll. It's named Beautiful Doll, from Colonel John D. Lander's big, beautiful doll, P-51. So if you hear the word doll, you know what I'm saying. What you're looking at now is a Garmin display. It's experimental system, although some of the radios are certified. Garmin figured out that they had a lot to offer to us experimental people. We're making more airplanes than the certified people were making. And they went to work with a crew that were really good and also home builders. They called them the X team and said, there's a computer, go pull anything you need out of it. You can get stuff from the G1000, which is their top of the line stuff at the time, and design us some experimental stuff. So we kind of got G1000 light here for a fraction of the cost. So Garmin did us a good thing here. But anyhow, starting on the left side at the top, this is a audio panel, GMA 245. It's Bluetooth. I can have my iPhone in the cockpit someplace and it'll play all my music from my music files in flight. And of course it's a regular audio panel that does all the usual functions of an audio panel, and it's a very nice unit. This is a certified unit here. It's a GTN 650 XI. I purchased the 650, but when the XI came out, I decided to upgrade it because it can do some really neat things in approaches. And this is an older transponder. It's a GTX 330, but it also had the extended squitter capability. So when the 2020 deadline came for having ADS-B out, it could do that. These two units together work together to do that job to identify this airplane in space for the FAA. And this is the autopilot controller, and it's very convenient. Like I say, why didn't I put that on the top? Well, there was a couple of physical reasons. This radio was so long, it had to be about there to fit and miss all the cross beams and stuff. And I could either put the audio panel down here or the autopilot panel up there. And I said, which one do I really use the most? So I figured it was the audio panel, and you reach down and hit a button and it cruises for hours, right? Okay, these two screens are identical. They are touch screens. We really waited for the portrait touch 7-inch screens to come. They were the last to be introduced, and they are marvelous. Both of them are identical, and they'll both do each other's job. So if this one were to fail, everything would jump over to that one immediately, and vice versa. Now this little guy down here is a standalone. It's called a G5, and it's completely standalone. It's using aircraft bus power right now, but it has a backup battery and will run for 4 hours. And it does even more than that. When you go with Garmin, everything talks to everything else that is so integrated. A lot of guys mix and match. They buy Garmin navigators because there's just nothing better than them. They're the best by far. So they'll buy that and maybe a different brand screen, and then they have trouble getting things to interface. I don't understand that. But if the Atahar's unit that drives the gyros and everything in this were to fail, this unit will automatically, from its little internal unit, drive that screen. So I've got triple redundancy. If the screen fails, that one does it. If the Atahar's fails, this one drives those. All because all the Garmin stuff talks to everything else. When I got the autopilot in here, I changed from the original autopilot to the Garmin autopilot. I couldn't believe how smooth it was. I was flying the 777 for American Airlines, which at the time was state of the art, and it had a very capable autopilot, and it was very smooth. And all of a sudden I turned this one on, and that's what it reminded me of. It flew as smooth and tracked as nice as the 777 did. Now the 777's avionics were state of the art in the 90s, and this stuff is actually better. It gives more features. It has, of course, the synthetic vision, and you can actually fly an approach under the hood or IFR visually on that screen, just flying to the runway like it was the real runway. Of course, you would be watching the raw data for glide slope and everything else, but you could literally fly to an airport and land on it IFR on the screen like you're shooting a visual approach. I'm not recommending that. I'm just telling you how nice this stuff is compared to what I had in even a state-of-the-art airliner. It had nothing like that. So anyhow, upgraded originally from steam gauges because this stuff didn't exist then, and if you got anything like it, it would have cost more than the airplane. And when it came out, I went with the first generation Garmin G3X, and then they updated it to the touch stuff. Had to have it so the DAW gets the best, and that's what it is. I'm running it right now for you with this little power supply. That's why this yellow wire's here. So I can run it without having the master switch on. This is my fuel panel down here. And I designed it specifically because John Denver was killed in a very easy for a fuel valve reason, which I thought was actually ridiculous. And I decided I'd build my fuel panel where it was intuitively obvious to the most casual observer. I put the knob on backwards and ground off the little pointer that was right here. And I designed it to point to the gauge that it's feeding from. And you see the black line on the underneath it. That's so if I don't feel it click, I can look down and make sure it's lined up with that line and I know the valve is in the right place. And so it just points to the fuel tank it is sucking fuel from, and the gauges are Stewart Warners that tell me pretty closely what full, quarter, half, empty are. Of course, for actual navigation fuel-wise, I use the Garmin's flight computer. It's set up for three things: fuel remaining, fuel used, and FOD, which is fuel over destination. If I'm flying along and I've got 8 on the FOD, that means I've got 1 hour of fuel remaining when I land, because I'm usually cruising at around 8 to 8.5 gallons per hour. So with those three indications, I don't even have to go to the fuel computer page to look for more. It'll give you endurance and range and all kinds of stuff. But those three numbers right there tell me at a glance how my cross country is going. Okay, if you notice, there's 3 screws here, and then on the other side, 3 more. All the boxes, the trays that hold the radios are all put together on the other side, and then they have 3 blind nuts to line up with these 3 screws. So if I needed to get this out of here, I take, slide that out, so just slide them out. You know how easy that works. Then I take these 6 screws out, and the tray stays with the airplane. The panels come out with one screw on each corner, that's 4 each, and there's just 1 for the G5. And then I just take out the stainless steel socket screws. You notice they're socket screws because you can get at those at an angle. You don't have to hold a screwdriver straight into a number 8 Phillips screw, which is hard to do over on the sides. I timed myself the last time I took that out, and you see it just like it is now. I had the panel out, everything out, in 8 minutes. And that makes it, getting to all the stuff in the back, and a lot of guys use remote radios behind the panel, to access those can be a real problem. So if they were to follow my image here, third panel generation, they would be able to access everything in 8 minutes. Sometimes I tell myself, instead of trying to struggle through the holes of one of these screens to get to something, just to stop and go ahead and take it out. It's only 8 minutes, and then you got full access. So that's something to think about if you're building one of these airplanes. Think about working on it later. You don't want to be head first down there with your head on those rudder pedals looking up. I guarantee you that.
I'm going to talk about this back here.
Okay, my wife wanted a screen too, so I got one for her, and I designed this little stuff out of scrap aluminum I had left when I built this airplane. And it has pins I can pull that will take it out instantly. And so it's attached to the back of the seat and then down here. And so to get it out of the way, you just lift up and break some Velcro loose, and it's folded up and Velcro hose it there. So my wife could get in and out, or anybody who gets in the back of the airplane doesn't have it sticking out here in the way. But once they're seated, just pull it out, and there it is. And it can also be a flight display. See, with a switch right here for multi-flight display to pilot flight display, just like that. And they always have the engine instruments at the top. So this is a real nice thing for somebody in the back. If I want to let somebody fly from the back, they've got the stick, they've got a throttle, and they've got the flight display for flying the airplane. So, and she quit asking me, when will we get there? Where are we right now? So she really loves her display in the back. Yeah, that's the cockpit. Well, I want you guys to notice that the center panel here has no switches on it, no lights, no warning lights, nothing. It's absolutely clean, and there's a reason for that. Like I said, this is my third panel, and every time I did it, I tried to make it easier to work on the airplane, repair, get to access, and I had all the switches I needed right down here on the right panel, which was Van's original design for the circuits on the RV. Anybody had bought his prepackaged electronic panel or electrical system, that's how he wanted you to put the switches. Whenever I fly somebody other's 8 and they had used the same switchology, it really makes it easy for them to fly the airplane. Some of them I gotta look all over the place to find out where what is. My wife and I built this RV-8 starting in September 22nd, 1997. I saw the airplane for the first time that Oshkosh. I was going to Oshkosh in 96 when they first introduced it, but my airplane broke down and I ended up turning around flying home, didn't make it to Oshkosh in 96. When I made it to 97, I walked up to Van's display like I always do and I went, oh no, no, no. I saw the airplane I've been waiting for a long time and I knew I was gonna build it. And I tried to talk myself out of it because I knew I'd get obsessed and spend all my time building it. And as it is, I built this slow build kit in 2 years and 7 months. And that's including the paint job. And most people take much more time than that to build a quick build kit. So I was right about being obsessed about it, but I couldn't stop. And I'm glad I did. It was one of the smartest decisions I ever made. This airplane started in 97. I first flew it on July 12th of 2000. So that makes her 22 years old flying last month. And she looks. She looks pretty much like she did 22 years ago. I just wish I did, because I don't. I was much younger then, thinner, all those things. But anyhow, I used to have 3 airplanes to fly. I used one to go cross country. It was a Grumman Yankee. I had a Christian Eagle biplane I owned with another guy. That was just to go out and do aerobatics. And I had a J3 Cub. It was just wonderful to fly around slow with the door open. Once I got this flying, those all went. No, this won't fly as slow as a Cub with the door open, but it does pretty good aerobatics, and not as good as the Eagle, but enough for an older guy. And it's a much better cross-country airplane, which we'll talk about in a minute. Anyhow, my wife was down in that turtle deck back there in a very small space with a bucking bar when we were riveting that on. When she came out, I couldn't fit back there. She had to do it. But anyhow, when she came out, she said, I decided we're going to do a military paint scheme. And I said, dear, I've got kind of a red, white, and blue thing in my head there. No, we're going to do a military paint scheme. And I said, okay, you earned that right to pick the paint scheme. And I had built a model of a big, beautiful doll, P-51 Mustang, of Colonel John D. Landers of the 78th Fighter Group in England. That airplane today is hanging from the ceiling of the Imperial War Museum in downtown London. In the center position, you'd think the Spitfire would be there, but it's not. It's a big, beautiful doll. It was my favorite P-51, as it is a lot of people's. You'll see it. Anytime you see a book on it, you usually have a picture of big, beautiful doll on it. So, and I built the model on the back wall. You see a P-51 Mustang model on the wall. That's the one I had built before I even thought about building this airplane. So I went in the house and I pulled the fuselage out and hung it on the garage rails while I was doing the final work on this. And the more I stared at it, the model, the more I realized it might look work on this airplane. And so I did it. And the response to it when I took it to Oshkosh was really amazing. But anyhow, that's why it's called Beautiful Doll. It's not Big Beautiful Doll, because it isn't big. And I didn't put WZ1 on it, which was Colonel Anderson's numbers. I put RV-8 on it to tell what it was to people who didn't know. But I saw that it did have sort of the profile of the P-51. I'm not sure that was an accident by Van. Everybody loves the 51, and the 8s were immediately popular for that reason, I think. But anyhow, I chose the big engine that the IO360A1B6, it's an angle valve engine, and it would not be my choice today, but it was the only one back in the 90s that I could get without a scoop down here for a carburetor. I knew I was going to checkerboard it, so I didn't see how you could possibly checkerboard an inlet scoop for a carbureted engine, so I bought the only one with forward-facing fuel injection, which is this engine. And the reason I wouldn't use it today is there's better choices. Even Lycoming makes a parallel valve forward-facing fuel injection. I think it's called the M1B. Superior makes a beautiful engine clone of the Lycoming. It is parallel valve with cold air induction, which is probably the one I put in it today. And ECI, which I think was bought out by somebody, they also make a clone Lycoming engine with a forward-facing fuel injection. So that's what I would choose. And the reason is because this engine weighs about 30 pounds more than the parallel valve engines, which you have to compensate for when you put this engine and a Hartzell propeller on. I have a great big battery in the back, a typical aircraft 25 amp Concorde, just offset some of the weight of this baby. But she goes, she really does go. But anyhow, this is a Hartzell propeller. It doesn't look like it because I painted it black with yellow tips, and that's only because it matched the big beautiful doll's propeller. If it could be four-bladed, it would even look better, but this engine can't turn a four-bladed propeller, and they don't make one for it anyway. So anyhow, that's the engine in here. It's flown now for just under 1,800 hours, and this year has already made one trip to Colorado, to Durango and back, and then just got back from Oshkosh a couple weeks ago. So she's a great transportation airplane. Many, many times I've taken off at Oshkosh and landed right here without stopping, and still had an hour of fuel remaining, because I won't break that rule. I always land with an hour remaining. She's pretty straightforward. There's very few modifications on her at all. Pretty much went along with what Van decided, because he designed such a good airplane. Everybody has to personalize their fairings. I went to a lot of trouble to make these fairings smoothly flow into the airplane. And then I decided I didn't want to cut it apart in the back to pull it off this way. So I put more laminations in here, and I literally used the two screws that hold that door, gear access door on, that holds this on. And I had to paint it mid-strut because I couldn't get it off the strut. But I like the fact that it's clean and it doesn't have any splits in it. The wheel pan splits down the middle and plugs together here in the center. And they're probably the most maintenance you'll do on your RVs since they take such a beating. I've had to repaint them a couple of times and repair little dings they get. But all in all, that they work really, really well. And I do nice grass landings. I've followed Doug Reeves up to Johnson Creek, Idaho, and landed on the grass runway way up at high altitude 1 year. It's one of the most fun things. I had to go back and do it again with the wife after I told her about it. Okay, the RV-8 has an advantage of having a forward cargo compartment and an aft cargo compartment. This one being forward of the center of gravity. Anything you load here moves the center of gravity forward. Of course, anything you put back there moves it back. And when you're going to Oshkosh, you're taking lots of stuff, chairs, tents, bed rolls, air mattresses. I end up putting all the heavy stuff here and all the fluff stuff back there, like bed rolls, my wife's 20-pound suitcase. My wife, she's a featherweight, thank goodness. Anyhow, the airplane is in perfect center of gravity when I take off, 1,800 pound gross weight. And it gets airborne in about 500 feet and still climbs 1,500 feet per minute. What a machine. To do that with 23 foot wing is just, well, like Van calls it, total performance. I use the duck light landing lights, but then everybody upgraded them to these LED lights, which are much brighter. And I don't do that much night flying, but when I do, they really light up the runway. You'll notice there's an extra door right here. There's a couple of guys that build RV-4 across town. Really great craftsmen, beautiful airplanes, but RV-4 only held like 36 gallons. So they made a tubular tank that ran down through the wing and came, their tank stopped down here somewhere. Our stop's here. And I asked them, when are you gonna make a tank, extended range tank for the 8 and the 7, since they share the wing? He said, well, we got a guy on the field right now who's going to bring his airplane over when he's ready, and we're going to do his. I said, I'll bring mine to you tomorrow. So he said, bring it over. So they did the work because they were fitting how the tank would work in an 8-7. And it adds 4.5 gallons here and 4.5 gallons on the other side, which is just happens to be 9 gallons or 1 hour of cruise. So that turns into my reserve fuel. Any RVA can fly directly to Oshkosh or directly here on 42 gallons. Well, that's exactly how much the mains hold. So you'd be doing the shuttle one arrival if you tried that without the aux tanks. But with these, I can continue for another hour. The range of this airplane would be from Oshkosh to Austin, and then it would be doing the shuttle one arrival. Very capable airplane. Oh, by the way, it does that in about 4 hours and 40 minutes. For those, it took 3 days to drive from here to Oshkosh this year. All right.
What about the wingtip?
Okay. I started out with different and incandescent lighted lights all the way around the airplane as the solid state LED type came out. I changed them all out. This little unit I welded, I believe, and it's a tail light, it's a strobe, and it's a position light all in one. And it's down below the wing, so it doesn't flash in my eyes, and it works really well. And I can turn everything on now, and the airplane with all the avionics running, as long as I don't transmit it with a microphone, it's pulling just about 10 amps, okay? So I only have a 40 amp generator for the belt driven generator, BNC, the best on the market, by the way. I'm not pushing BNC, I don't get any kickbacks, but I put the BNC on there 21 years ago, and it has been running now for 21 years. The first year I had one of the other automotive type, and it lasted less than 100 hours. So I also put one in the tail light here. It was funny, the guy who was the designee to sign this airplane off said, "Why do you have three? The two on the wingtips and one back here. And you're only supposed to have two." And I said, "No, wait a minute. I flew the 727 and it had one on each wingtip and one up in the tail. It had three." So then he left me alone. This aircraft is painted with Glaceret paint. I consider myself an experienced amateur. If I practice a little bit, I can get back up to speed to paint without getting runs everywhere. There are some mistakes in this airplane. Like I said, I'm an experienced amateur, but there's no way I could paint this airplane all in one piece in a metallic color, because every day you'd have to do it all at once if you wanted it all to be the same color. So I did it in pieces, but then you have different days, different temperature, different humidities. So every piece would be a different color of silver. So I did it in base coat where you spray it and the paint dries almost immediately like lacquer does, and then make it shiny, put clear on it. It's not as tough or rugged as single stage color, but an amateur like me can get a pretty good result with an airplane like this. And the paint is so high quality, 22 years later, it still looks pretty much like it did day one. I updated the tail well. I've had about three or four of them on here, and this is the final one and the best one. Yeah, that big circle right there is a big bearing carrying the main loads. But up here in the top part, where this thing turns, it's all roller bearings. They usually use a brass insert there, and they wear till the tailwheel does this, and it gets hard to turn. This one turns so easily that it's almost like it's floating on water when you're pushing it backwards. Before, I could hear the bulkheads up in there that this spring is attached to clicking as I pushed it sideways. And I said, that can't be good. It's stressing the rivets holding the tail unit in there between the bulkheads. Put this on there, it all went away. And by the way, with this one, you push the rudder down and the airplane turns. You don't have to use any brake or force it. It just follows your feet because there's so little drag in this tail. It's advertised on Doug Reeves, VansAirForce.net ad pages. I can't remember the name. There's an initial like J&B or I can't remember.
JD Air.
Anyhow. Yeah. It's not cheap, but it's worth every penny, and it actually protects the airplane. When I get her ready to go to Oshkosh, I wax her once a year, and I polish things that they're already starting to get scuffed up, but you don't want to paint anything that you don't have to paint. Originally, I painted the canopy rails, and it wasn't long before my feet and other people's feet chipped them up. And so I called Van, how much are these? $5.50. $5.50? Yeah. Send me two of them. So I polished them up before I even installed them, replacing the old painted ones. And so once a year, I use a little metal awl and shine them up, and it really is a better way to go. This was once painted with the interior paint, and people hold it here, and I don't know what's on people's hands, but it literally was like paint remover, and this was cracking. And so I took it out, and I stripped it, and I took it to a motorcycle chrome shop, and they chromed it for me. And now it's, and I had them do this little canopy latch at the same time. So it's lasted years now without any degradation at all. Only it gets really hot in the bright sunlight. People ask me where I got this. This comes square. All I did was ground it down and fine finish it and then buff it. This is the part that comes with the kit. But it looks a whole lot better streamlined like this, and you see it polishes up like it's chrome, but it's just aluminum. It's the original part. Well, anyhow, this airplane, like I said, is 22 years old. I've flown it almost all four corners of the United States, and it's been to Oshkosh every year but two. Now, 2 years ago, they didn't have Oshkosh. That's one of them. And the other one was when I upgraded on the 777. I was the most junior captain on 777, and I had no clout at all. And they sent me TDY for a month, and it just happened to be July. So I couldn't go to Oshkosh with the airplane. I did make it there for 3 days, and everybody asked me, where's the doll? I said, it's in the hangar in Texas. That's where it is. But I go every year because I used to go for the airplanes, but now I go for just seeing all the people I've met there over the years that have become really friends. If you've never made the Oshkosh Air Show, I recommend you do it. Put it on your bucket list. It's if you make it while you're still young, you'll make more than one trip, I promise. Anyhow, this is my little RV-8. My wife and I built it. I'm an airline pilot. I'm not an aeronautical engineer. I'm not an aircraft mechanic. But I just had the passion to do it. And I think anybody who wants to build one of these, it only takes two things. Obviously, it takes the money required, and it takes tenacity, because it's almost a religion to finish one of these. But if you do, you will not regret it. There's nothing you can buy from a manufacturer that comes even close to one of these. Once you fly one of them, you get into one of those spam cans, you go, oh my God, I actually enjoyed flying these. So I know that sounds pretty nasty, but it's just the fact that these airplanes don't have the compromises that certified aircraft have. They have to be built for the weakest link, and they have to be made really tough. And RVs can be, or home builds can be made to do a certain function. And Vans aircraft seems to do all of them pretty well. It's not the fastest airplane with an IO360 A1B6, but it's pretty fast. Cruises over 200 miles an hour. It doesn't fly as slow as a Cub, but it doesn't stall any faster than a Cessna 150. So. It accelerates, it climbs, it does aerobatics. It's beautiful to look at. I mean, what more do you want? Anyhow, it's been a pleasure telling you about it. I hope you enjoy it, and have a good day.